Life, it is messy, okay? Let's just be honest. There was, I was reading about a mother and a son, and like a parent, you know, sometimes with your children, they don't always wake up for church on time. So her kid's sleeping upstairs, and she yells up at him, says, "Hey, it's time to get up for church. You're going to be late." And usually, what do your kids do? They don't respond back, right? Because why? They're tired. They want to sleep in. And so she yelled up, "You better get up." And so he's still laying there, and he responds, and he says, "I'm not going to church today, and I'll give you two reasons. Number one, they don't like me, and number two, I don't like them." And she says, "Well, guess what? You're still getting up, and you're going to church, and I'll give you two reasons. Number one, you're 50 years old, and number two, you're the preacher." Oh, man, isn't that bad? I thought that was so funny. But it is all about how you view church, how you view life. There is something to be said for a mindset. The mind is very, very powerful. Did you know that the mind has between 12,000 and 50,000 thoughts per day? Those are a lot of thoughts. And if you really think about it, I mean, you're probably going to have thousands of different thoughts that run through your mind throughout this sermon alone. Now, here's what's interesting. Our biology is slanted towards negativity. We actually focus more on things that are negative. There is a biological connection that we have a survival instinct, and so our minds do tend to look towards the negative more often than the positive. And so that's why, for instance, all you have to do is turn on the news. And what you look at the news almost every single day. You look on Instagram almost every single day, or Twitter or Facebook. And there's a lot of negativity that's shared because there's something captivating, not just in the story of negativity itself, but also ingrained kind of in our DNA. Things we do slant towards the negative. There was a study that was done by doctors about couples. And this is really interesting. The mind, that if it perceives a majority between a husband and wife, a majority of negative experiences, the marriage more likely will end in divorce. In fact, if you don't have 5 positive to every 1 negative experiences each day, the marriage won't be healthy. And we're not talking about big birthday bashes or going on a long vacation. We're talking about 5 positive little moments throughout the day of hope and positivity. And that's pretty astounding. That shows you just how powerful negativity can be on our minds. And when we think about our own Christian life, when we think about who we are as a follower of Jesus, that kind of negativity is not just in our own relationships with each other, but it can actually carry over into our relationship with God. How many negative thoughts have you had about God? God doesn't love me. I'm not good enough. Did he really die for my sins? Am I really a Christian? Am I really accepted at church? Do people really love me? And so all of this negativity can overflow into our relationship with God and with each other. And so you can see when Paul writes here in Colossians chapter 3 how a new mindset is the foundation for a new lifestyle in Christ Jesus. And so that's what we're going to talk about. Now, can you imagine the state of a mind that has 50,000 different thoughts a day, with a biology that's slanted towards negativity, compounded with negative life experiences? I mean, this last week has been crazy, has it not? I mean, California fires, to election issues, to gun violence. I mean, it has just been a really, really terrible week, and news is outpacing itself every day, and all we want to do is turn on and watch the news because we can't believe how many negative things go on. And so then you come to church, and you hear, guess what? You're a dirty, rotten sinner, and you're going straight to hell. I mean, you want to talk about a negative relationship with God, that's going to be it. And I know I'm laughing, but sometimes that's what churches do. And so we want to look at what the Bible wants to teach us about how we should think and how we should live. I played high school football, loved to play football. I wanted to go play in college, and the Lord captivated my heart, and I knew I wanted to be a preacher. But I'll never forget, it was my junior year in high school, second game of the season. We were getting ready to play. I grew up in Ohio, and it was about 45 minutes outside of the capital, Columbus. And so we were getting ready to play a team from Columbus, and about all the Columbus teams are good, okay? I mean, they had a 6'6", 320-pound defensive tackle. I mean, these guys were stacked, okay? And I can remember we had a terrible week of practice, and our coaches stood there and they told us, "You guys are going to get your butts kicked tomorrow." And they chose to use a few different words, okay, that I can't use from the stage. But basically, it was, "You guys stink and you're going to get beat tomorrow." And guess what happened? We got owned the next day. If you tell yourself that you're going to lose, you're probably going to lose. And as Christians, if we tell ourselves that we are not alive with Christ, we're probably going to live like we're dead. If we don't tell ourselves that we are new in Christ Jesus, we're probably going to live like the old us. And so if you'll read along with me in Colossians chapter 3, starting in verse 1, we're going to look at what it means to have a new mindset. This is what Paul says. Therefore, if you have been raised with Christ, keep seeking the things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on things of the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. And so look at that first verse that he says. If you have been raised with Christ, and you have, you're not dead. You're not dead in your trespasses and in your sins. You are new. You are alive. You are a living person in Christ with God. And Paul dealt with this in Colossians chapter 2. If you just turn back to the previous chapter, and you'll see in Colossians chapter 2, here's what he says. He says, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were raised up with him through faith and the working of God who raised him from the dead. He says, look, you were immersed into Christ. That was when God saved you. That was when your faith resurrected yourself into a new life with God. And so he points back to the baptism, and he says, if you have been raised with Christ, if you have obeyed the gospel, you are alive, you are not dead. And so what does it mean if we've been united with Christ, not in his death, not in his burial, but in his resurrection? It means this. Our ties that bind us to the old world order and impose itself upon us is finally broken. Those habits you used to have, they don't have to be the same habits that you have today. Those sins you used to struggle with, they don't have to be the same sins that you deal with today. You now have the ability to overcome the struggles of your past. But there's still a problem. While we may be alive on the inside, what do we have to deal with? We have to deal with a body that is still tattered and ridden with sin. We have lived our lives in such a way for so long that we have instincts and our biology kicks into gear, and we constantly have to suppress the sins of the flesh. And this is true for everything. Sex, greed, you want more, power, money, anything, everything, food, all of these things are connected and tied with our bodies. And that's what Paul's going to deal with when he gets into our lifestyle a little bit more. But how is this brand new life pursued? Okay, the ties of the old life are broken and they're gone. How do I pursue a new life? Well, Paul gives us that information in verse 2. Look what he says. Keep seeking the things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Man, we have to get our minds engaged in the battle. We are not going to get out of the baptistry and then boom, a lightning bolt hits us and all of a sudden we no longer struggle with the sins of our past. In fact, we probably will find the longer that we're a Christian, the more we come to know God, the harder the struggle is. That's what C.S. Lewis believed. And he believed Christianity was hard work. It's what we call when we stand before God, we're totally guilt-free. He doesn't judge us. He doesn't condemn us. But we still have sins that we struggle with that we call our sanctification. And the only way to get more holy is if you engage your mind and you keep seeking the things that are above. And not in a mystical sense. It's not some nirvana that you're trying to attain, but it is in a person. It is through a relationship. Famous coach John Wooden, he said this, champions never complain because they're too busy getting better. And that same truth should be us for Christians today. We complain sometimes about things that are utterly unimportant. Just think about your relationship with your spouse or your relationship with your parents or your kids. How many times do you complain about things that absolutely do not matter? Who ate the last donut? You know what I'm saying? That's something I complain about. It's probably me. I actually have been cutting out donuts, believe it or not. All right, I'm not allowed to lie because I'm a Christian, but yes, thank you. And so I've only had 3 today, okay? So I'm eliminating them slowly but surely. I'm just kidding. I haven't had any today. But he wants us to keep seeking things that are above, not things that are of the earth. And if we overwhelm our minds and our life with everything that's negative, that's what we're probably going to follow. If all we look at are things of the earth and not things above, we have the direction to go to things of the earth. And so that's why we shouldn't allow ourselves to be overcome with things that are just negative and we complain all the time. We should be so busy pursuing the things that are above, that we don't have time for the things that are of this earth. We should be seeking Jesus's interests, not the interests of our own, and sulking in our own sorrows. And you know what? Jesus is not interested in us complaining about things that we necessarily just don't like. Jesus is interested in us winning souls to Christ, and he's interested in us becoming more holy and pursuing things like he is interested in, loving God, speaking the truth, overcoming the battles of the temptations that we struggle with. The Apostle Paul put it like this: do all things without grumbling or disputing. And that's a pretty high bar that we go throughout this life, and we're not supposed to grumble and complain, but let's see what we can accomplish. You know, everything in life is an opportunity if you choose to view it that way. If you are seeking the things that are above, every obstacle that you come into, every negative experience that you have is an opportunity to seek heavenly things. The question is, where's your mind at? Are you going to be seeking the things that are above when those negative things happen to you? You see, as I said, it's not some mystical nirvana that we're seeking, but what does it say, verse 2? Where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. We are seeking a personal relationship with Jesus. And if we're seeking him, his interests become our interests. When we start seeking who he is, we start becoming interested in the things that he's interested in. It's like this: Angel and I, we got married. Just celebrated 10 years of marriage. It's awesome. Give her a round of applause. Yes, that's right. And she says, you know, you always do this up on stage, but you never do it behind closed doors. That's not true. Sometimes I do give myself a round of applause behind closed doors, okay? But here's the thing. When Angel and I got married, she didn't know who the Ohio State Buckeyes were, but I convinced her to take pictures with me in an Ohio State jersey, and because she loves me, right, she started becoming interested in the things that I'm interested in. And I am totally ashamed to admit this, but before I met Angel, I did not drink coffee at all. Okay, I really don't know how I survived, but she introduced me to coffee. My wife absolutely loves coffee, okay? She drinks coffee every day. She's obsessed with it, and I'm glad because I'm obsessed with it too. We love coffee. It's calorie-free. Did you know that? As long as you don't put like sugar, creamer, and stuff like that in it. But it is awesome. Coffee's awesome. I never cared about coffee until I met my wife, and she introduced me to coffee. And I bet the same thing is true for you. You think about your spouse, and you think about who you were before you met the other person, and how maybe some of their interests became some of your interests, and vice versa. Or even parents, right? You want your kids to love the things that you're interested in. But we need to be careful. As parents, we need to be interested in the things that our kids are interested in as well. It's a mutual relationship, right? So this is the same thing for our relationship with God. When we become married to Jesus, his interests become our interests. And that can only be accomplished by seeking things that are above. And this is such good news. It is such good news. Verse 2 is such good news. Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Do you know what that means? That means that your resurrection has the seal of approval. He sat down. The work is finished. You don't need to go around questioning whether or not you're saved or whether or not God loves you or whether or not you're really truly alive in Christ. You only need to start obeying and behaving. Not as if you're trying to earn your salvation, but because God has saved you. And so there's so much rich theology packed in these first few verses. Look what he goes on to say. He repeats himself, but just in a different way. He says, set your mind on things above, not on things that are of the earth. In other words, don't let your ambitions be set on things of the earth because they die and they fade away. Well, what does it mean to set our mind on things above? Okay, do I just focus on Jesus sitting on some weird throne in heaven that's like immaterial, right? I mean, what does it mean to actually set your mind on things above? Well, look what he says in verse 3. He says, we have died and our life is hidden with Christ in God. You know, sometimes I don't feel like I'm saved, as I said earlier. Sometimes I do feel like a dirty, rotten sinner and a failure. But I need to constantly remind myself that my life is hidden where? In Christ with God. I don't have to worry. I don't have to fear. I don't have to complain. I don't have to be negative. I need to look to the New Testament, and I need to remind myself I'm a saved man, despite how terrible I feel at this moment, and that is so much grace from God. Often the battle is something that we need to have in our minds and remind ourselves of who we are in Christ, and that God has loved us, and our mistakes and our failures and our shortcomings and all of these sins that we have struggled with and do struggle with, we need to remind ourselves, my life is hidden with Christ in God. And that can set the victory for us overcoming our sin. You will never overcome the things that you struggle with if you don't believe Christ overcame them on the cross. I mean, I want you to think of it like this. There was a 65-year-old man named Yoram. He lived in Jerusalem. Not too long ago, there was a fire in West Jerusalem right where he lived, and he had to flee. He woke up on a cold November night, November the 2nd, and he had to flee his house because this fire was going to consume him and everything that he owned. And so he grabbed a few personal precious items. He ran down to his car. He got out, and guess what he found? Everybody else is trying to leave as well. And so now he's in this long line of cars that people are trying to escape this fire. Well, finally, he gets out. He escapes. Well, he was an artist. He had 2,000 paintings and 1,500 drawings, and they were all gone. They were all left in smoke. Didn't recover anything. His entire life's work was gone like that. But you know what the good news is for those of us who are in Christ? Our life is hidden with him. And no matter how much we lose, no matter how much we miss out, we will never lose the eternal aspect of our life hidden with Christ in God. It's forever. And so, yes, we struggle. Yes, we fall short. Yes, we fail. Yes, we lose. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. Set your mind on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Why should we do that? For your life is hidden with Christ in God. And no matter how much you lose out on this life, you'll never lose that. And that gives us motivation. This battle of the mind is serious business. It is the real deal. Your lifestyle will never fall in line if you can't begin the battle of, I'm going to set my mind on heavenly things. And that's the fact that Jesus died for me. And my life is hidden with him in Christ, in God. And that no matter what happens, I can never lose. And when you start teaching and believing that about yourself, you're going to be able to get your lifestyle in line. Look what he goes on to say in verse 4. This is something else that we should think about. This is what it means to set our minds on things above, not just the atonement that we have. Look what he says in verse 4. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you will also be revealed with him in glory. So it's not just the fact that Jesus died for your sins and he covers up your mistakes, but it's also that when he comes again, you're going to be with him. Forever. And so it really puts the exclamation point on the Christian life. Your sins are paid for, and you're going to live forever with God. And if you lost 2,000 paintings in your house because of a fire, you will not lose out on the things that matter in an eternal sense. And those are the promises we have in the first four verses. A new mindset comes because you're alive now in Jesus. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? Do you believe that God loves you and that your life is hidden with him and that you will be with him when he comes back? If you even have an inkling of no, you need to set your mind on things above, and you need to tell yourself as many times as it takes for you to be convinced of this truth. If you were buried with him in baptism, you are alive through your faith in the working of God. And that is a promise that we have. And when we get at that new mindset, we can have the next point that we're going to talk about is a new lifestyle. John Maxwell, one of my favorite guys to listen to. I read his books, listen to his podcasts. Here's what he says. Dreams don't work unless you do. And let me tell you something, church friends. Becoming a holy Christian isn't going to work unless you do. It's not a supernatural spark plug that just happens overnight. We are saved before the throne of God, and he gives us his Holy Spirit to overcome our mortal sins. But if you're not willing to do something about it, it isn't going to happen. And so sanctification is hard work. Look what Paul says here. He goes on, starting in verse 5. We're going to get there in just a few moments. But here's what I want to say. The promises of a new mindset can only be carried out in the practice of a new lifestyle. The old practices are to be abandoned, and brand new practices are to be adopted. And so this is something that we must do. And so here's what Paul is really getting at. It's not enough just to have a firm theological grasp of Christianity. You've got to live it out. It's not just enough to believe the essentials. You have to obey the essentials. It's not just enough to show up at church and hear stuff. You got to do it. And that's what James says in James 1:22. Be doers of the word and not hearers only. And so Paul's going to really unpackage this, what it means to have a new lifestyle. The first thing that he gets into is this idea of putting off. And man, this is a good reminder. We need to be reminded about the things that we need to get off of us. And if you can think of it like this, it's like having a dirty, nasty, raggy shirt. Right? You get done with the gym, or you've been outside working all day and you got mud and blood and sweat all over you, and then you come home and you sit on your nice furniture. What's going to happen to your nice furniture? It's going to stink. Okay? It's going to smell. I was with Kyle, our student minister, the other day in my truck. And believe it or not, okay, I do work out, okay? You all know I love donuts, and I know you can't tell by the physical appearance, but I do try to work out at least once a month. And so I wasn't putting a towel down on the back of my chair, and so my sweat was sitting right, and both of us got into the truck. I was like, man, what's that smell? He's like, dude, that is B.O., and I'm like, ooh, this is gross. And so now I try to, cover up my car seat, and here's the thing. If we don't take off the old, the new is going to get corrupted, and that's what Paul's saying here. You've got this filthy, nasty, dirty garment on, and you got to get rid of it. You got to take it off. Get rid of it. Put it to death. Don't even donate it to Goodwill, okay? You just got to throw it in the dumpster. That's the idea that he's saying here. Look what he says in verse 5. He says, therefore, consider, because we're setting our minds on things above, consider the members of your earthly body as dead, and here's the list, immorality, impurity, passions, evil desires, and greed, which amounts to idolatry. And so, boom, first thing that he hits is sexual sin. Put it to death. That doesn't mean sex is bad or sex is sinful, but there are certain kinds of sexual sins that we need to get rid of. They struggled with it 2,000 years ago. We struggle with it 2,000 years later, and we need to put it to death. Verse 6, for it is because of these things that the wrath of God will come upon the sons of disobedience. And in them you also once walked. This is who you used to be. This was the coat you used to wear. This was the person you used to be. He says, when you were living in them, but now, put aside, and he gives us another list, anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive speech from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you laid aside the old self with its evil practices and have put on the new self who is being renewed to a true knowledge according to the image of the one who created him, a renewal in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave or free man, but Christ is all in all. Now notice what he says in verse 5. Consider your earthly members of your body dead. Let that old man who already died in baptism stay dead. And he's going to try to resurrect every single day of your life. And you have to get up every single day of your life and say, I'm going to set my mind on things above, and I am not going to be the old man I used to be. Maybe there's one of these, this is not an exhaustive list, but maybe there's one of these things that you used to struggle with. And Paul wants us to know, we have the ability to live free. If we recognize these sins that we're struggling with, we have the ability to overcome it because our inner man is no longer enslaved. Our inner man is renewed. He is alive, and he can overcome these struggles of the past by the power of the Holy Spirit. You see, God, when he saved us in the watery grave of baptism, he made us alive new, but we came up out of that baptism with the same old fleshly struggles that we've always struggled with, but now we're aware. Now inside, we're alive. And see, sin has seized our bodies, but now sin can be made powerless. It can be made ineffective. It can be put out of commission. It can be inoperable. You can throw it away if you so choose to. And so while our inner man is redeemed and renewed and resurrected, our sin-infested bodies must be actively killed and put to death until Jesus comes back and we get a new body and a new nature. I want you to think of it like this. We've got this inner man that now has gained control over our body. Before you were a Christian, you just gave into your impulses like that. You thought something, you said something. You felt something, you did something. You gave into your passions, you really probably didn't feel any conviction unless it was the moral law working on your heart. But when it comes to this list, these really weren't things that you were absolutely convicted about. But Paul says, now you're alive. Now you're aware. Now you have the Holy Spirit. Now you have the inspired word of God. Now you have other people to fellowship with. You can be new if you choose to be. And so the body has lost the willing spirit. And that's what I have seen, the difference that it's made in me. Yeah, I've made mistakes, no doubt about it. I struggle with sins, no doubt about it, and you do too. But my spirit is unwilling. I don't want to do these things. It's often, man, it just happens, and my passions get the best of me, and I'm overcome in the twinkling of an eye. It's just like that. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? It's like before you even know it, you've had that outburst of rage, and afterwards you're like, I can't believe I acted like that. Or I can't believe I said those things. Or I can't believe I believed that thought. Or I can't believe I did that action. Isn't that true? When you sin and you struggle, you often look back, you're like, man, I was just so overcome by the moment. It's that flesh. It's creeping up in our lives. And we've got to make the willful decision to set our minds on things above, to always be mentally engaged. I got to put that old life down. I've got to die to who I used to be. And notice what he says. All of these things, he summarizes at the end of verse 5. He says, these things amount to what? Idolatry. Idol worship. We are worshiping the sins of our flesh rather than God. And so this is the real deal. Let me explain to you about these sins that he lists. First of all, he says immorality. It's the Greek word pornos. It's where we get the word pornography. It's basically sex with harlots. It's prostitution. It is sex outside of God's design. And the Greco-Roman society, sex with prostitutes really wasn't looked down upon. In fact, it was a normal part of their society. As long as you didn't overindulge. And Paul comes along and he says, oh, no, 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 the standard for Christians is much different. We should not be looking at pornography. We should not be having sex with prostitutes. That's what it means to be immoral. He goes to this other word, means impure, impurity. It's misusing sex. And we know things like this when there's fear or there's pain or there's certain kinds of sex that the body just isn't capable of maintaining. It actually does damage to the body. There are some things that many of us are aware of in our society, and it promotes and it propagates. He says, this is a sin of the flesh, and the wrath of God is coming upon this. And so we need to put these desires that we have in control. Basically, to be impure is to have a desire that goes beyond its intended boundaries. Okay? You have a sexual desire, and it goes too far. You have a sexual thought, and you never push stop. That's what he's talking about. Number 3, passion. Passion is a strong, shameful, and dishonorable feeling that does not honor God. That's what it means to have a passion. Or evil desires. Evil desires is an intense desire or a longing for disgusting sexual acts. That's what that is. And Paul says, you need to put those things to death. And then finally, covetousness. He uses the word greed. There's an Old Testament Bible verse. It says, do not covet your neighbor's wife. And so Paul isn't pulling any punches. If you want to set your mind on things above, Paul, the first thing that he deals with is you got to get sexual sins under control. And I think that we as a church and our culture, we need to get sexual sins under control because it's damaging to who we are in Christ Jesus. It makes us go towards the old man, not the new. It makes us dead, not alive. And so those are the first things that Paul deals with. And Paul says, look, you used to walk this way. This is who you used to be. Don't go back. And then the second list that he gives, anger, is the first one. It means to rage or have an outburst of passion because of an ongoing, unsettled anger. It's like pressure that slowly builds up inside of a pipe and then, boom, explodes. He says, that's not who you should be. And then he says, wrath. This is passion-driven anger. The difference between a person who blows a gasket and then somebody who's just always angry, it's like you're walking on eggshells every time you're around this person. You don't know if you're going to say the wrong thing or do the wrong thing. They're just always angry. They're just a wrathful person. And Paul says you need to get rid of that kind of passion-driven rage. And often, it emerges out of these things that we feel very strongly about. And so it's a strong impulse. It's almost like you didn't even think about it. You just merely reacted. Paul says, you got to put that under control. The third thing that he mentions is malice. Malicious behavior. It's like a wolf in sheep's clothing. Outwardly, they don't look evil. But inwardly, they are plotting and they are scheming and they are thinking, how can I take advantage of this person or this situation? Paul says, you got to put it to death. Slander. Blasphemy is the word. It means to switch what is right for what is wrong. It means to call good and godly things evil things. That's exactly what he's saying here. It's a speech that injures a person's good name. You make somebody out to be a villain. And we know what this is like. Politics, that's all that they do. They just throw mud at each other and hope something sticks. That's not how Christians are to behave. That's not the kind of life that we are called to. We are called to rise above slander and put it to death. And then finally, abusive speech from your mouth. This is dirty talk. It's locker room talk. It's the kind of talk that you'd be humiliated if someone overheard you. I'll never forget this. I was in the fifth grade, and I was sitting at lunch as a fifth grader, and I really wanted to impress the people around me, and that came at the expense of other people in my life. And I remember this. I'll never forget it because I was so humiliated. We had this kid named Josh. He was in our fifth grade. Brilliant dude. I mean, the guy is like a genius. Didn't know it at the time, of course. But Josh was always kind of an awkward guy. In fact, every time that he laughed, smiled, or talked, he would always go like this, like this. And so here I was sitting at lunch with my friends. I was like, dude, what's up with Josh? You know, and I'm making fun of him. And I'm like, he's always doing this. I want, you know, and I'm poking fun at him. And they're all just kind of looking at me like this, wide-eyed, because he's sitting right next to me. Humiliated, even as a fifth grader. And I wish I could say that's the last time I was humiliated with something that I said. All right? It happens all the time. I'm like, I am such a moron. Why do you say things like that? You're stupid. You ever feel like that? You're like, I wish I wouldn't have said that, or I wish I wouldn't have thought that. It happens more often than what we want to admit. Dirty talk, sex jokes, dirty jokes, things that poke fun and make fun of people's body parts. I mean, Paul says this is abusive speech, and you've got to get rid of it. That's the kind of life that we are not to live in. And look what he says in verse 9. He says, don't lie to one another. Your mouth was not created so that you could speak lies, but so that you could speak truth. And so here's the question. Why should we put off these old, dirty garments? He says this, because you are being renewed in the image of the one who created you. You're renewing yourself. You don't struggle with those sinful habits and attitudes. You're getting rid of them. That's why, because Christ died for you. But not just that. Look what he goes on to say in verse 11. He says, but even the barriers that divided us are now gone. And then he goes through, and first of all, he lists racial distinctions, Jew and Gentile. They're gone. That's one of the reasons why you should put these things to death. Because often our abuse towards other people comes because of race. And it's true. Racism is a nasty, evil sin. And a person who is a racist and claims to be a Christian is not going to go to heaven, simply put. End of discussion. Bottom line, you can't be a racist and belong to Jesus. It's absolutely true. Religious barriers. He says to the circumcised and the uncircumcised, that barrier is gone. They're rejected. And so just because you do different bodily things, so the Jews were circumcised, the Greeks were uncircumcised, and Paul says that doesn't matter anymore. The barrier's gone. Thirdly, cultural barriers. He says Greeks and barbarians, they're cut off. And so what if you like certain styles of music that other people don't like? Or so what if you don't like certain styles of music? I mean, it doesn't matter. So what if you don't like how somebody dresses or where they come from or the cultural things that are sacred to them? It doesn't matter anymore. We're one, he says. We're united. We're together. And then he says social barriers, free or slave. It doesn't matter how much money you make. It doesn't matter how rich you are or how poor you are. Those things don't matter anymore. This is what's at stake. This is why we should put the old man down, is because these barriers are gone. We are free. That's really what Paul was saying. We are free. Live as free people should. In Romans chapter 3, Paul says, all are freely justified by his grace through Christ Jesus. Everybody, we are all justified freely by God's grace. And that includes all of those barriers. And so what he's getting to is simply this. These sinful habits are clothes that you have outgrown. They don't fit anymore. And sometimes we like to hold on to those clothes that don't fit, right? I know, especially when you're gaining weight. You're like, I refuse to buy more clothes because I'm not going there. I'm not going to who I used to be. And so we should be saying, man, these clothes are so baggy, they just don't fit anymore. I got to go out and buy a whole new wardrobe because I'm dropping all this dead weight of who I used to be. And that's what Paul was saying here. Get rid of them. But here's the thing. We know that Christianity is not just a list of things that you don't do, right? I mean, you don't want to come to church and all you hear is, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this, don't do that. And there's a lot of people who do teach that kind of gospel. Christianity is not just about what you shouldn't do, but it's about what you should do, what you should be pursuing. And so it comes at no surprise that Paul says, look, you shouldn't just be running from sin. You should be running towards God. Look what he says in verse 12. He says, so, as those who have been chosen by God, holy and beloved, put on. Get yourself a new wardrobe. Put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another, and forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, how? Just as the Lord forgave you, so you should also. And beyond all of these things, which is the perfect bond of unity, put on love. And so it's not just about things that you shouldn't do. It's not just about things that you're running from. It's about things that you should do and things that you're running to. And he says in verse 12, because you've been chosen by God, put on. Think about that for a moment. Before God ever created the world, he foreknew your free will decision to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And he chose you. He chose you based on your free will decision. That says a lot about how God thinks of you. You're not a loser. You're not a dirty, rotten sinner, even though you are a sinner. You're not hated by God. You're loved. You're died for. Your life is hidden with Christ in God. You're alive and you're new. And you have the ability to put these things on. Because you have a brand new mind and a brand new attitude, you can have a brand new lifestyle and you can put on brand new habits. Everything about your life, about your marriage, about your job, about your family can be brand new if you're willing to submit to the Lordship of Jesus. And so he says, put on compassion. It literally means, the Greek word means to come from your bowels. The Greeks thought that your emotions, that your deep care for someone came from the pit of your stomach. And so that's where the Greek word comes from. It's a deep gut-felt emotion. It's mercy, where you just don't give somebody something that they deserve. That's what compassion is. You have compassion on someone. And so you can only have compassion on people in the church? Oh no, this is for everybody. Second of all, he says kindness. Jesus put it like this in Luke 6:35. He says, the Most High, speaking of God, is kind to the ungrateful and to the wicked. And man, I'd be lying if I didn't say it is tough to be kind to people who are ungrateful, isn't it? I mean, it's really tough. Ungrateful people, self-entitled people, they are a group of people that I struggle with. But yet God says, look, I'm kind to them and you should be kind, just like I am to you, Rick Bonifield. And so this really refers to the meeting the needs of others without cruelty. That's what it means to be kind. You're going to meet the needs that they have, whether it's a deep inner need or a material need, and you're not going to be cruel or harsh in the process. Humility. To be low in human pride and self-assertedness. You don't think less of yourself. You just think of yourself less. Putting others and their needs above yourself. And so we shouldn't exalt ourselves. And then he says gentleness. This literally means you don't give way to rage. Jesus says the gentle will inherit the earth. And if you think about this, it makes sense. People who are constantly malicious and mean and angry and always looking to exercise being cruel, they end up devouring themselves. You ever notice that? They just eat themselves alive and then there's nobody left except for the gentle people. And so don't lose your gentleness because Jesus was gentle. Malicious people tear each other apart and literally, it's what obviously leads to war. He says, be patient. Put on patience. It literally means long-suffering. Do you know what's a good definition for long-suffering? To suffer long. And we don't want to suffer for very long because suffering doesn't feel very good. And God's like, yeah, tell me about it, Rick. Okay? I've been suffering with you for all of this time. And so you need to go and be long-suffering with the people around you. Bob Goff put it like this, love difficult people because you're one of them. Isn't that true? Love difficult people because you are one of them. And so we need to be patient. And you know how you get patience? Man, if you pray for patience, you are in a world of trouble. The Bible says patience cometh through tribulation. And so if you've been praying for patience and bad things keep happening, it's because God is giving you the trouble that you need to become a patient person. And so I had a preacher told me this. He says, Rick, don't pray for patience. Just tell God you'll work on it, okay? And so maybe you can do that same thing. Just tell God I'll work on it, all right? I'll put it on. Don't send me through that, Lord. And so God does this with us. He is patient and long-suffering with us. And in 1 Corinthians 13, Paul says, love is patient. and it is kind. And so it comes at no surprise that he ends it with this: bear with one another and forgive. How should we forgive? Just as the Lord forgave you. And so if God is willing to rid himself of your sin and he's willing to cast it out from the scene, we should be willing to do this to the people around us. And it's really tough, but it's a daily decision. And finally, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. This is the Greek word agape. It's self-sacrificing love. Christian love means to deny yourself. It means to sacrifice what you want, because love is a verb. It's not just a word. It's something that you do. It's not just something that you feel.